is safe within your name. This we know, this we know. You promise never to forsake. What you began, you will sustain. This we know, this we know.
As we begin our worship time this morning, I want to root us in Psalm 95 as a call to worship. It says this: Come, let's sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let's come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth. And the mountain peaks, they belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let's bow down and worship. Let's kneel before the Lord our Maker. Many of you have walked in here this morning on top of a mountain. You're experiencing great joy in your life, and I think it would be safe to say that there are many here this morning who are in the middle of a valley. And God wants to meet you where you're at this morning. And I think we would be remiss if we didn't pray for our brothers and our sisters in Saskatchewan, given everything that's gone on over the weekend with the Humboldt Broncos hockey team. And as we gather here and praise our Lord and Savior, there are families all across our country who are grieving. And we stand with them this morning. And so would you stand with me? Father, we give you praise and we give you glory for who you are. And I thank you that in the midst of sorrow and in the midst of trauma and in the midst of deep, deep valleys, you promise to walk with us. And so, Father, our hearts go out to those who are experiencing loss this weekend. And we just declare that you are God and you are good and we don't understand. And but we're going to praise you and we're going to give you glory for who you are. You are worthy of our praise, Father. We pray this in the matchless name of Jesus. Remain standing as we worship. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all, for from you are all things, and to you are all things.
deserve the glory. You are worthy of it all. You are worthy of it all. For from you are all things, and to you are all things. You deserve the glory.
For who you are, give you praise that you are present with us. God, as we gather, I pray that the songs that we sing, the truth that we hear proclaimed this morning would transform us by your Spirit. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you're present. We give this morning and these hours, these minutes to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, welcome to Chilliwack Alliance Church. We are so glad that you're here and that you're worshiping with us. It's hard to believe Easter is already 1 week gone behind us, but we are going to celebrate an empty tomb this morning through baptism. So we are so excited about what God is going to do and what God's going to say. Why don't you turn around, greet someone around you, welcome them here, and then I know we've got some visitors with us, and then remain standing as we worship.
Thank you. wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you. None like you. Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you. None like you. Our God is greater. Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God.
Into the darkness.
Into the darkness you shine. Out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you.
Our God's greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our God.
Our God's greater.
Our God is greater. Stronger, God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God, our
God's for us.
If our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against?
Greater.
Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
Our God, and if God's for us,
and if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what could stand against? Then what could stand against? Our God is greater. Our God is stronger. You are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God,
let's sing that one more time.
Our God is greater, our God is stronger. God, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power.
Be all that.
were sleepy, thy presence my life. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever
love, you bring light to the dark. Isn't it good to come into God's house this morning to sing his praises? As we sing, he's with us. His spirit is with us. So good. Children, you are now dismissed to go to your kids' church. And it really is great to see you this morning. My name is Mark, and I'm part of the team here at Chilliwack Alliance. And Dwayne alluded to it a little earlier. What a fantastic weekend we had last weekend on Easter. It was so good to see this place full. It was so good to see us all singing and praising our risen Lord and Savior. And we celebrated baptism, and we've got more baptisms coming this morning. May that continue every week. And Pastor Leon will be really pleased if we got baptisms every week here. That'd be tremendous. Ushers, if you could join me at the front, I'd appreciate that too now. And if you are new here, welcome. It's great to see you this morning. It's great for you to come and worship with us. And in the pew in front of you, there's a little connection card. We use that for a number of reasons. And if you're new, fill it in. And just walk outside the sanctuary and keep turning left. You'll go to our information center. And we'd love to give you a gift there after worship. Equally, it's a great communication tool. If you want to communicate with us in any way, fill that in and let us know. And we can connect with you during the week. It's amazing how time flies by, and now we are at the last term for Bible studies before church. It's amazing. Summer will be here. I look outside. It's not like summer at the moment, but it will be here soon. And so this is, we're now entering into our last semester for study at 9 o'clock before worship. After service today, if you're interested, if you're a man, we hear lots in this church about ladies and what ladies are doing all the time in our church. Well, men, there's an opportunity for you, if you'd like to, after worship today, meet Pastor Matt and the team in the chapel to find out what's happening and what's going to be happening in men's ministry here at the church. And a little bit of a pre-warning here. If you're interested in soccer, we've got Flow Soccer coming back. A group of professional soccer players come in, they coach our kids during the summer, and they preach the gospel at the same time. And that's coming in the near future, so watch out for registrations for that coming down the track very, very soon. You all have a bulletin. When you came in this morning, please read it, please look into it. There's lots in there, there's lots of things happening in the life of the church. And if you can't be bothered to look at the paper, go on Facebook or look at the church app or go on the website. There's a myriad of ways you can keep connected with what's happening in the life here at Chilliwack Alliance. And there's almost something going on for you each week. So make sure you do check in with that. Because we want to connect with you and want you to feel part of the church family here. Let's pray. Father, we do give you thanks. We give you thanks that you are here amongst us now. We give you thanks that we're able to come here freely and worship you and give you all the praise and all the glory because you are our risen Lord. As we breathe, it's your breath that's in our lungs. Help us, Lord, to really shine and that people will see that the faith that we have makes such a difference. And Father, thank you for this offering. May it be used to truly glorify your church so we can extend your worship, we can extend your kingdom, not only here in Chilliwack, but throughout the world. So bless our offering, bless our time, and just be with us. And Lord, just help us to really remember that you are here right now with us. Help us to open up our hearts so that we can truly glorify you. In your name I pray. Amen.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
To worship, why don't you stand with us?
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings.
Who rules the nations?
Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That for me.
All right, we're going to try something here. Let's all clap together if we can. And when I stop, don't stop. We'll just keep this going. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
There we go.
Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You've done for me.
All that you've done for me. Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning, Video Cafe again. It is a good day. Two baptisms, 2 weeks in a row. We love it. And it's also nice, before we move on, to see that Stephen and Phyllis Lee are back again today. And they've already spoken to me. They are ready to get baptized. I'm sure if they had their shorts with them, they'd be in here today, right now. But, you know, you just don't want to walk around in a wet suit all that much. So, baptisms are a really special time in life for the church. In some religions, in some kind of systems of belief, people understand baptism to be a means of cleansing. They understand baptism to be something that you have to do in order to be made right in God's sight. You have to get baptized in order to get cleansed. But the Bible tells us that that's not the case. The Bible tells us that we are saved but by grace. It's only through what Jesus Christ has done that we can be saved from our sins. And so in that, what baptism is that it's an identification on the part of the believer with Jesus Christ. If you're a believer, what you do is you come to the baptistry tank and you say, you know, I know that it's only through Christ that I can be saved. I know it's only through Christ that I can be cleansed. And so you come and you get baptized because Jesus said, be baptized. If you're a believer and you haven't been baptized, I encourage you to get baptized. You email me, you talk to me. We'd love to have you as a part of one of these baptismal services. But everyone needs to be baptized. And today we have two young men who are coming before you all to say that they are identifying with Christ. They have given their lives, they have given their sin over to Jesus, the first of whom is Stephen Clay.
Hello, my name is Stephen Clay. When I was born, the doctors didn't think I would survive. Not only was I born 3 months early, I was also very sick. There were several times that my brother and I were dying. But we survived. Throughout my childhood, I had several surgeries that could have claimed my life. The thought of dying was very real to me. Even though I grew up in a Christian home, I didn't accept Christ at a young age. I had seen many adults baptized here that had turned away from God during their teen and young adult years. I didn't want to do that to God, so I refused to make the commitment. When I woke up from a surgery at the age of 12 years old, I kept praising God and thanking the staff for saving my life. My mom saw my fear and waited a few days before asking if I was ready to choose God. That was March 1st, 2010. My fear of dying was gone with that prayer. I want to live for Christ. I am being baptized today because I want to publicly declare my love and faith in God. I am not supposed to be alive. I am not supposed to be able to walk. The doctors were not wrong. God was gracious. If you haven't chosen Christ, I hope you do. You can do anything. Just pray. My parents did. They never gave up. You shouldn't either. I never will.
And here he is, Stephen Clay, alive and walking in the tank with me. Now, we do like to have an encourager as part of our baptism services. And Stephen's encourager is George Brody, who is wonderful, but who also lives in Revelstoke. So that's a bit of a problem. But, you know, we're not to be daunted, and neither was George. And so George sent through a video encouragement for Stephen as well. Let's have a look at that, please.
Hey, Stephen. It's George here from Revelstoke. I am very honored that you asked me to be your encourager on this your day of your baptism. It's phenomenal and very exciting that you're taking this step of obedience. I know it's something that we had talked about several times when I was down there in Chilliwack. You are a young man who is courageous, who loves Jesus, who loves other people, and who doesn't let difficulties hold him back. So it is awesome that you are publicly declaring your faith in Jesus today in front of the church and in front of the world. And I encourage you to be an evangelist, to be a preacher, to spread God's word, because at the end of the day, it is only salvation that matters. Nothing else matters. I have a few verses for you that I would like to read to you today to encourage you in this step. And it's from Matthew chapter 6. And let me read this. This is from verse 25 to the end of the chapter. It's Jesus speaking, Sermon of the Mount. That is why I tell you, do not worry about everyday life. Whether you have enough food or drink or enough clothes to wear, isn't life more than food and your body more than clothing? Look at the birds. They don't plant or harvest or store food in barns, for your heavenly Father feeds them, and aren't you far more valuable to him than they are? Can all your worries add a single moment to your life? And why worry about your clothing? Look at the lilies of the field and how they grow. They don't work or make their clothing, yet Solomon, in all of his glory, was not dressed as beautifully as they are. And if God cares so wonderfully for wildflowers that are here today and thrown into the fire tomorrow, he will certainly care for you. Why do you have so little faith? So don't worry about these things, saying, what will we eat or what will we drink or what will we wear? These things dominate the thoughts of unbelievers, but your heavenly Father already knows all your needs. Seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. So don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring its own worries. Today's trouble is enough for today. And particularly this verse, Stephen, seek the kingdom of God above all else and live righteously, and he will give you everything you need. That is proven to be true in so many people's lives throughout the centuries, and I'm sure you're finding it true in your own life. So continue to seek God first, continue to put him first, and just see what he does for you. It's going to be amazing. Good job, Stephen. Go get dunked.
You're well-loved, Stephen. In the tank, we also have Kevin Dick, who's also special in Stephen's life, and he gets to help me baptize you. It's wonderful. So, just before I baptize you, let me ask you a few questions. First of all, Stephen, do you love Jesus?
Yes.
Have you placed your faith and trust in him for salvation and eternal life?
Yes.
Is it your will and intention to live for him every day of your life, submitting yourself to him and his lordship in your life?
Yes.
On the basis of this testimony you've heard from your lips and seen in your life, Kevin, would you come? We baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. So Riley.
And I attend Rosedale Middle School. I live with my two older brothers, Charles and Parker, and my parents, Greg and Jim. I grew up in a Christian home, and accepted Christ at the age of 4. But the problem with growing up as a pastor's child is that it is easy to go with the flow and not actually truly have your own relationship with God. When I turned 11, however, I started talking to my parents about my faith and the possibility of maybe getting baptized. But it wasn't until last year at Kakwa Summer Camp that I truly decided I was ready to take this next step. My camp leader, Ace, had a huge impact on my spiritual journey. He shared his own experiences in a way that I could truly understand and helped me to see what baptism is truly about. Today, I want to take this next step in my faith and publicly declare that I want Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I want to submit myself to him as his devoted follower, and I want to show this by getting baptized as he commands us to.
Well, good morning. And this is my son, Riley Zacharias, today, and he wants to follow in the waters of baptism, follow his Lord and Savior. So what an exciting thing to do as a parent, to be able to baptize your own child. So I highly recommend that. This is a great day, and we're so thankful. And we have a number of extended family here today, too, to support Riley. We're proud of him. We're proud of the decisions he's making to follow Lord Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Riley, who have you chosen as your encourager today?
My mother.
I have the same problem you have. Riley, Dad and I have been praying towards this day since you were a baby, and we couldn't be more thrilled or proud of you. We've prayed that not only would you know Jesus as your Savior, but that he would become your best friend, the one you lean on and trust completely. We've prayed that your journey would keep you close to him, no matter what you face in life. We've prayed that you would choose to listen to his voice and walk in obedience, honoring him in all you do, say, and think. Today, we are so excited to see so many of our prayers being answered, and it feels particularly fitting to share your favorite verse from Isaiah 30, verse 21. Whether you turn to the right or to the left, your ears will hear a voice behind you saying, "This is the way, walk in it." Riley, since you were very young, it has been abundantly clear that God has shaped you and gifted you with unique talents and a charming personality. All along, I felt that God has given you a huge responsibility, just as it says in Luke 12, verse 48. From everyone who has been given much, much will be demanded, and from the one who has been entrusted with much, much more will be asked. As you continue in your faith journey, you will find that you will be faced with many choices, not the least being that you will need to choose who you will serve. I would like to encourage you, don't give the enemy the satisfaction of being able to use your God-given abilities for his purposes, which he surely would love to do, but submit yourself to the Lord and his purposes in your life. Everyone, whether they walk in faith or not, chooses who they will serve. My prayer for you as you grow up and one day begin your own family is that the following verse would be firmly nailed on the doorpost of your heart. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Joshua 24, verse 15. As you continue to spend time in God's word and your relationship with him grows and flourishes, I have no doubt that his voice will become more and more clear to you. And with this will come a wonderful peace, just as it says in Philippians 4, verse 7, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. I'd like to leave you with one final verse, Riley, from Hebrews. And though it is for all who profess faith in Jesus, I've taken the liberty of personalizing it for you today. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, equip Riley with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in Riley what is pleasing to him, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. I love you, Riley, and I'm so proud of you.
Amen. I just want to pray for Riley before we baptize him. Father, thank you for my son, Riley. I love him. I'm grateful that you've given us this gift for the time that we have. And Father, I pray that you would empower him with your spirit for life in the spirit, empowered to do kingdom work. And we just pray that you'd bless and you'd guide and you'd use this day as one that he'd always remember as pivotal in his life and his walk with you. So bless and guide, we pray in Jesus' name. So, Riley, do you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? If so?
I do.
Do you desire to follow him all the days of your life?
I do.
Then, in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I baptize you today and bless you. Thank you.
Christian life is a radical life. It's not a go with wider culture kind of a life. It's going a different way. You hear words like submit to God today. And that's not what our culture teaches. And I am always thankful when believers will actually take Jesus seriously and will seek to be devoted to him. May this continue in our church. Do I hear a bit of an amen here? We're going to look into today and next Sunday our profound teachings of Jesus. I hope that you'll be awake the next two Sundays. And if you would take your Bible today and go to the book of John, chapter 15. If you are finding that you're, let me say this, if you're using the Pew Bible in front of you today in the main house, it's page 803. Video Cafe, it's page 1081, John 15. If you are a Christian, but your life is marked by defeat, underperformance, and being moved by the wind back and forth, and you find that your Christian life is not, it's not like a victorious kind of a Christian life, your Christian life is boring, then you're going to want to listen the next two Sundays, and I think there will be something here for you. Didn't we have a time last weekend with Easter services? Wasn't that amazing? Good Friday is always so wonderful for me to be a part of. As I just watched, for those of you who weren't here, we have stations around the room, and just to see the people of God flocking to the table of God is just a real blessing for me personally. And then Easter Sunday morning, early in the graveyard, very poignant to think about resurrection when you're standing in a graveyard on Easter Sunday morning. And then last Sunday morning in our service, I just felt it was really God-honoring. I felt it lifted up Jesus in an appropriate way. I felt we did what we could do as a congregation to let him be seen as great. And so I just have wonderful memories about our Easter time. So let's get into our passage for this morning, and it's all about vines and branches. So Carol and me and our family lived in Kelowna for a number of years, and one of the lovely memories I have of living in Kelowna was driving by a vineyard, a great vineyard, every day on my way to work. And the wonderful memory that I have is when you'd be driving in the fall and it would be warm. It's been really quite hot there through the summer, and it's still kind of the residual warm of fall, and they're getting ready for harvest time, and you're driving through the warm air and you can smell the fruit hanging on the branches. The perfume of the grapes, heavy and waiting to be harvested off of the hillside. What a great memory that is. And the great aroma of the fruit hanging. And this is the picture that Israel had of themselves. They saw themselves as the grapevines of God. And that if you drove by Israel, spiritually speaking, you could smell the aroma of spiritual fruitfulness coming from the Israelite people. That's what they believed. That's what they saw themselves at. And Asaph, who was a music pastor and wrote a number of the Psalms, said in Psalm 80, "You to God, you brought a vine out of Egypt through the Exodus. You brought a vine out of Egypt. You drove out the nations out of the land of Canaan, and you planted that vine. You cleared the ground for it, and it took root, and it filled the land." Israel saw themselves as the planting of God. They were the vine of God. They were planted in that place to be fruitful in representing God to the world. In doing God's work, they were planted there for that reason. They were to produce God's kind of fruit and show to the world what it's like for people to be in relationship, in a symbiotic relationship with God. So, how did they do? Are you reading through the Bible this year? I'm in 1 Samuel right now, and they did not do well at being the vine of God. In fact, Isaiah said in chapter 5, verse 7, "The vineyard of the Lord Almighty is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are the garden of his delight. And God looked for justice, but he saw bloodshed. He looked for righteousness, but instead he heard cries of distress." So often, the vineyard of God did not produce the fruit of God and faced repeated judgments because of that. However, even in the days of Jesus, the Israelite people saw themselves as the vine of God. If you read the historian Josephus, he talks about at the great temple, the great Herodian temple in Jerusalem, he says that the front gates of the Herodian temple were decorated with enormous gold-covered vines. And he said they depicted bunches of grapes on the gates of the temple that were as tall as a man. The point being, even at the temple of God, we are the people of God. During the Jewish revolt, one of the Jewish revolts between 66 and 70 AD against Rome, the rebels minted their own coins, and I have been able to procure one of those coins, and on the back side of the coin, they don't put a head on there because you don't make an image of someone. And so on the back side of the coin, what have they depicted? They've depicted a grapevine with grapes hanging from it. They're saying, "We are the true Jewish people. And in revolt against Rome, we want you to know who we are. We are the vine of God." Now, as we go into our passage today, for those of you who are visiting with us today, we've been going through the Gospel of John. And in the Gospel of John, Jesus makes many claims about who he is. And it all takes root from Exodus chapter 3, when Moses went to the burning bush and God gave him the call to lead his people out of Egypt and plant that vine in Canaan. And Moses said, "Who shall I say has sent me?" And God said, "I am." That's the name. You tell them, "I am has sent you. I am the eternal one. I am the pre-existent one. I am." And in the book of John, many times Jesus says, "I am, I am," referring back to the calling of Moses in Exodus 3. He says, "I am the bread of life. I am the living water. Drink of me." He says, and it was very incendiary, he says, "Before Abraham was, I am." He said, "I am the resurrection and the life," around the death and raising of Lazarus. He said, "I am the good shepherd. I am the gate for the sheep. I am the light of the world. I am the Messiah, the promised one," he said to the woman at the well. And now we come to John chapter 15 and follow as we read through the first 17 verses of this passage where Jesus says, I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit, he trims clean so that it will be even more fruitful. You, disciples, are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine. You are the branches. If a man or woman remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not remain in me, he or she is like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. That's quite a statement. As the Father has loved me, so I love you. So remain in my love. And if you obey my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands, and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than one lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I learned from my Father I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last. And then the Father will give you whatever you ask in my name. This is my command: love each other. So Israel, as the vine of God, was an imperfect foreshadowing of the true vine. Jesus says, not that Israel is the vine, Jesus says that he is the vine. That Jesus is the one through whom the fruit of God is produced. So this whole passage, as he talks to his disciples and as we, his disciples, read it, is all about fruitfulness. God has designed, he looks for fruitfulness in his disciples. So let's talk for a few minutes about the fruitful and the fruitless Christian. So if you have anything going spiritually at all in your life, anything, if you're wanting to be Christian at all, you want to see something happen out of your Christian life, don't you? Like what Christian would ever say? I mean, they'd ever say, look, God, just give me a ticket to heaven. That's all I want, right? I don't want anything else. I don't want any people or any work, or I don't want any service. I don't want to do anything. I just want to be a fat toad on a lily pad. That's all I want. And then when the time comes for me to die, I want to jump off of that lily pad into a heavenly lily pad. That's all I want. Like, is any Christian ever going to say that? Truly, I mean, even if you think it, you better not say it. If there's anything happening spiritually in your life as a Christian, you're going to have a feeling of, I ought to do something. I ought to look like something. I ought to be something. To somehow be useful for God. Wouldn't that make sense? So there's a story of two new work crews who are on their first work crew jobs putting in power poles. And they have a foreman, and he has these two crews, and he puts them to work on a certain day and just to see how they will do. And at the end of the day, the two crews came back to the foreman, and he said, so how many power poles did you put in? And the first crew said, well, we put in 12 power poles. And the foreman said, well, that's not bad. He said to the other crew, how many power poles did you put in? They said, we put in 2 power poles. And he was shocked. He said, this crew put in 12 power poles and you only put in 2? And the second crew said, yes, but you should have seen how much they left sticking out of the ground. In our work for Jesus, there is a difference between being busy and being effective. Jesus gives us an organic picture here in this passage for effectiveness. This is how you won't be just busy. This is how you'll be fruitful. And in this organic picture, he says, God is the vineyard owner. Jesus is the vine, and you and I are the branches of the vine. It is very important to get this. So let's talk a little bit about fruitfulness. So the vineyard owner plants a vineyard in order to get fruit. Not in order to get leaves. He wants to get fruit. That's why you have a vineyard, is to have fruit. So he goes among the branches. And the good branches he will prune, cut them back, so that it will produce fruit rather than simply leaves. Now we had a gardening crew come into our house, our yard this past week, and they did a bunch of work. And one of the things that they did is when my mom passed away, I planted a little tree to remember her, and. We planted it elsewhere, and it did very poorly there. And so when we moved to our current house, we dug this thing up, and I said, I'm going to give it one more chance before it joins Mom in the grave, and we're going to see if it'll grow here. Well, it grew like a weed. It's ridiculous. And it took maybe a season or two. It was quite shocked and thought it might not grow at all. And then it said, no, I think I'm going to grow. And so it looks terrible. So we had these gardening people come in this past week, and they pruned it, and it looked so pretty, but it was painful. They cut off big, long sucker branches like that all over the place, and our tree today, Mom's tree, is sitting there today going, oh, that was terrible, but it looks beautiful. Sometimes, and there's pruning going on all over town, sometimes pruning looks drastic. Doesn't it? If we prune trees, I grew up in Sherwood Park, Alberta, my high school. If we prune trees there, like we prune trees in Chilliwack, there would only be grass in Sherwood Park. But when it's well done, it makes for more healthy trees and more fruitful vines. So, brother or sister, today, if you are a Christian, if you are endeavoring to be a healthy Christian, the Lord will prune you. He will prune you. There will be some pain involved from the vineyard owner so that you will produce fruit. So, Dwayne alluded to it at the beginning of our time as he led this morning. And he led so well. That some in the house here today are feeling great and doing well and have a sense that they are under blessing. And others are going through a knothole and it is painful and it's tough and you're walking by faith. Perhaps today you are going through pain that is not a result of your sin. I think it gives us a different perspective for the Christian. If it's not as a result of our sin or our stupidity, but we are in a time of pain, perhaps the Lord sees that you can produce more fruit. Perhaps. Hebrews 4, verse 12 says that the Bible is a double-edged sword. It cuts, it divides. between bone and marrow. Has the Bible ever pruned you? Have you ever been pruned by the scriptures? If the Bible has never pruned you, then you are either not reading it or you are not paying attention. Because the Bible will absolutely prune you. God uses his people to prune us. Some well-meaning, some poor-meaning, but people will prune us. Has a Christian ever said anything to you that you needed to hear but didn't like? Maybe just don't get so huffy. Maybe just think perhaps that God is using someone to prune you. Last Good Friday at communion. Have you ever had communion prune you? If we don't come away from communion with a sense that I am a sinner in need of grace, that this is not due to me, it's all due to him. If we don't get put in our place in communion, then we should not take it. Because communion prunes us. It makes us humble before him who sacrificed himself. So we let the Father do what is best for our fruitfulness as he prunes us for maximum effectiveness for him. So Jesus is saying we should be fruitful, but there is also unfruitfulness, and he talks about it in this passage. Carol and I were on a holiday, and the place where we were staying, in the center of the table, was a big bowl filled with fake apples. And so we had guests come with us, and we were all kind of sitting around the table and talking and everything, and one of our guests was looking at the apples and just kind of turning them around and said, "Hey, wait a minute." And we looked at the apple, and there was a great big tooth mark chomp right out of that one apple there. I thought, next time, buy the real thing. Buy the real thing. If we don't remain organically linked to Jesus, we may do good things. We may produce what looks like apples, but they may not be real apples at all. They're not spiritual fruit. And Jesus talks about this a couple of times in this passage, but in verse 6, he says, "If anyone does not remain in me, they are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned." Who can read and love the verse that says, "I am the vine and you are the branches. Remain in me and produce much fruit"? Is it not disquieting to continue the passage and say, "But if you don't produce fruit, we'll cut you off and we'll burn you in the fire"? It's not a kind of a feel-good thing, so the plaque on your wall only goes, "I am the vine, you are the branches." chapter 10, verse 28, and in many other places in the New Testament, Jesus says, if you belong to me, if you are one of my sheep, you are in my hand. God has given you to me, and nobody will snatch you out of my hand. I believe that. I believe that. But I also believe this. While there are great biblical passages that speak to our security as a believer, there are also passages that are disquieting. And they say, do not take your salvation lightly. And so whoever this is given to, and I have read much on this, and as a result, I'm not even going to address it. For the parsing and the jots and tittles on this are myriad. Let me say this, though. Whatever this means, and whoever this means specifically, we as disciples need to pay attention to it and to make sure that we abide in the vine. Is this good? Let's abide in the vine. Let's not see how little we can be involved with the vine and endanger ourselves, whatever that means here. But let's abide in the vine. I liked what Stephen Clay said. My folks never gave up, and you should never give up, and I will never give up. I like that. Abide in the vine. How does a branch die? How does a branch wither, as Jesus says, from the vine? I think there's a number of ways that the branch withers. As we become legalistic and law-based, if we become self-centered, we dwell on ourselves instead of the vine. If we harbor unconfessed sin in our life, the life-giving sap that perhaps is the Holy Spirit flowing through the vine into us is cut off. If we disregard the scriptures, if we carry unforgiveness, if we carry bitterness in our heart, are these not surely things that will make us as a branch unfruitful and withering? We can't allow these things to shut off the life flowing from the vine so that we wither and die. The vineyard owner prunes the branches for fruitfulness, and the branches that are no good, he removes. So in this passage, as I have said, it's an organic thing, and Jesus says, remain in me, remain in me. Or other Bibles will say, abide in me. So it's interesting about being a disciple or being a Christian is not presented in a business model. Like it's not presented in the demand and supply. It's not presented in profit and loss. Jesus doesn't talk about that. He doesn't say, you know, if you invest 1 cent every day and then soon you'll have 10 million cents. He doesn't talk about that kind of thing. He doesn't talk about how big our Christian factory should be. It's not about technique to be a disciple, for as a branch, we have no innate source of life within us. We have no ability ourselves to produce anything spiritually lasting. We are just a branch. We're not a vine. We're just a branch. Our standing with God is not performance-based, but it's grace-based. The Lord does not love you because you're so talented. He doesn't love you because you're so good-looking, which you are. He doesn't love you because you are so well-spoken. He doesn't love you because of what you bring to the table. It's all about him in this equation as a disciple. And I just think it's very interesting as we look at this verse, remain in me. Look at verse 4. It says, remain in me, and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit in itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. If a man remains in me and I in him, if anyone does not remain in me, if you remain in me, verse 7, and my words remain in you, verse 9, as the Father has loved me, so I've loved you, now remain in my love. Verse 10, I've told you this so that your joy may be in you and may be made complete. So, are we getting the message here? Jesus is saying, please, if you're going to be a disciple, would you remain in me? Would you remain connected to me as a vine and a branch are connected together? One thing I never noticed when I was driving by that vineyard in Kelowna, I never heard the branches grunting and groaning to produce fruit. Never heard it. It was silent. It just sort of seemed to happen. Grape branches to produce grapes simply remain in the vine. And the grapes and the fruit just grows. This is what Jesus is saying. He's saying he's not giving you how many times you do this and how often you do that and where you go to do this. He doesn't talk about that. He says, please, remain in me and the fruit will follow. So our focus on disciples, and hear this, and if you only get one thing from today, it's this. Our focus as disciples is not on bearing fruit, but on remaining in the vine. Taking our life from Jesus. Jesus says in Revelation 3, verse 20, he says to a disciple, he says, I'm standing at the door of your life and I'm knocking. If you will open the door, I'll come into you and I will sup with you and you with me. In other words, we'll have dinner together. It's a relational thing. It's not a corporate thing. It's a relational thing. He wants to do life with us. He wants to live with us. And so we remain in him. There's many ways to remain in the vine. One is to talk with him. You know what I've taken to doing lately in prayer? Through the years, I have followed, largely, I have followed the Acts acrostic: adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. And that's been a pattern of mine for many years. But as of late, I've just been talking to the Lord, just kind of talking to him. And as it were, just kind of telling him where I'm at. So I sort of mix those two together, but I'm trying to remain in the vine. And so to have a back and forth with Jesus, we abide in the vine, we remain in the vine through his word. And we spend time in his word, and the Holy Spirit who inspired the word, if we desire to remain in Jesus, that's part of the Holy Spirit's job, is to lift up Jesus, to point out Jesus to us. And so we remain in him through the word, or through fellowship of the brothers and sisters. I usually sit over here, and I can kind of see. I can't see you in the video cafe. I have to take it by faith, but I can see in the main house here, and I see people enter in to worship, and enter into prayer corporately, and the sense of oneness that we have. It's a way for us to abide in the vine. Church isn't only for you. Church is also for the person beside you. And so over time, we come to think Jesus' thoughts, and we value what he values, and then he grows his fruit through us. Doesn't that sound a lot better than having a list of musts and do's and don'ts, but instead to abide, to remain? The great essential for the disciple is to be united to Jesus. And Paul talks about the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5, and he says this: the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. This is not talking about technique. This is talking about character. Those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the sinful nature with its passions and desires. What are these things here, the fruit of the Spirit? They're the character qualities of Jesus. This is a description of what Jesus is like. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. This is what Jesus is like. And as we remain in him, we begin to look like that. The Lord's been working on me for a long time on patience. The other ones I'm a little bit better on, but patience took a long time on that one. Taking a long time on that one. These are the character qualities of Jesus to be reproduced in us by the Spirit of Jesus. It's called sanctification. The holy walk. So as we remain in the vine and his lifeblood flows through us, we begin to look more and more like Jesus. We are walking the walk to heaven, and we are becoming more and more like the master that we follow. Sanctification, the holy walk. We call it in our church growing deep. Growing deep. It's a motion statement. We grow deep as we follow him. It is the power to be, and then we move to reaching wide, which is the power to do. This is the fruitful Christian life. So as we come to the end of our time today, let me talk just for a moment about the phrase, well done, good and faithful servant. So Jesus told a powerful story in the end of the book of Matthew about a wealthy man who went away for a while and entrusted varying amounts of money to three of his servants. And one of them simply took the money and he dug a hole and he buried it in the hole till his boss should return. While the other two took the money entrusted to them and they invested it so that they could see return from that investment. When the man returned, he went to the person who had simply buried the money and he gave him a scathing denunciation. Because the owner, the man who had entrusted the money, expected something back. He expected something to grow there. And then he said, and the man is God, and the servants are you and I. He said to the other two servants who had invested what he had entrusted to them, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. This is what I want to hear when I go before Jesus in heaven. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. Don't you want to hear this? Isn't this better than a frog leaping off the lily pad? To encounter he who is the vine and for him to say, you know what? You produce some things because you remained in me. Paul tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 3 that for every Christian, it's not a question of heaven or hell, but at some point in the future, every Christian will have a testing time for fruitfulness. Paul says, some of the things will be exposed to be wood, hay, and stubble, and they will be burned away. And some things will be exposed for gold, silver, and precious stones. And that's what we want to do, is as we remain in the vine, we want to be effective, we want to be fruitful, and those are not those are things that are coming from Jesus' character. We are told to lay up treasures in heaven. And there's lots of jokes about that, and, you know, why would you bring gold when we pave the streets with it and all that kind of thing. But, you know, as you think about it, how do you lay up treasures in heaven? What do you do? What do you do? How do I lay up treasures in heaven if I'm shy? I don't want to go in front of people. How do I lay up treasures in heaven if I can't sing very well? Or how do I lay up treasures in heaven if I can't speak well, or if I'm not convincing, or if I have no money? How do I lay up treasures in heaven? I believe we lay up treasures in heaven by remaining in the vine and letting him produce what he wants to produce through our life. I'm a baby boomer. I'm a baby boomer pastor. And when we all went to Bible school, we were in the swell of the baby boom. Those are the years of youth groups being 1,000 kids. You know, all that kind of thing. We think back and, we used to have daily vacation Bible school and we had 50,000 children. We brought them on buses. It's all demographics. And so I was in the swell of the boom. And a lot of us at Bible school went into ministry. And you know, baby boomers, we're raised after the war. We haven't been raised during a time of war. And so everything for us is up and to the right. In business, in entertainment, and in Christianity. It's up and to the right. It's all about church growth. It's all about, you know, happy and well-scrubbed people with two children or 1.8, somewhere in there. So when I went into ministry, that's what I expected. That's what I looked for. My ministry career was being set up well for this, so I went to our downtown Vancouver church with my dad, who was senior pastor here, all I could see was empty seats. It's just opportunity. The place was, had gone through sad times and less than half full and dispirited people. And I thought, great, I'll get in there and they will just, they'll think I'm super. And so as we had decided, my dad left after 2 years and left them stuck with me. And that next fall, I thought, we're going to end up closing this thing. It was as crushing as it could get for a pastor. And I went into a time of soul searching. Is this what it means to be a pastor? And I realized that rather than everything being up and to the right for a pastor, just like for the rest of the disciples, it's about dying. And painfully, I learned that message there. I had always liked people in the New Testament or in the Bible like Gideon. Wow, Gideon, he goes in there, only 300 guys. They clean out the Midianites. All they do is they break the pitcher and they toot on the trumpet and all the Midianites kill themselves. I thought, that's exactly what I want to do. I like those kind of guys. Take new ground, you know, push back the darkness. But now I had to come and learn to love Jeremiah. Jeremiah, who he never even got a Bible study group going, let alone grow some kind of a church. The end of the book, we find him in a mud-filled pit while the city of Jerusalem above him is destroyed. And then he's carried off into exile with all his faithless brothers and sisters. And I came to love Jeremiah. I always loved American mega churches. You know, like, have you ever heard these stories? We started our church in my living room with 4 people. And 4 weeks later, we had 10,000 people. And I go, I want that. I think that's terrific. But over that pruning time, I came to love instead faithful Russian pastors during communism who offered the word of life when things were not fun. I came to love them. It was probably the greatest pruning time in my ministry. And I came to understand that well done, good and faithful servant comes from being faithful to what Jesus has asked me to do. Well done, good and faithful servant comes from simply walking close to him and leaving the fruit to him to produce. He will care for the rest. And if this is true in my life, my friend, it is true in your life. Just be the young person or the man or woman who will remain in the vine. Amen. And let his life pour through you. Let him produce the character of Jesus in you. And then the fruit, whatever it is, we just give it to him anyway. Amen. This, I believe, is a good lesson for us. Now, as we close today, I want to give you a little bit of homework because you're saying, okay, what do I do? What do I do? Let me give you a little bit of a dying exercise for this week. No pens are raised to paper. Jesus said, verse 12, my command is this, love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, than one lay down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command. All right, so here's a little bit of a homework. Jesus challenges us to serve one another like he did the disciples. As we sacrifice ourselves for his sake, we become like him. So if you want a little bit of homework this week, if you're wanting to know what to do this week, then just ask a question. Who has a need, And first of all, among the disciples, who has a need that I can fill, pray for, or serve in Jesus' name? And in so doing, you would be like him. Just try it. Just try it. It will be good for you. It will be a pruning for you. Not to go for thanks, but to go as Jesus would go. Well, that might give us, if we all stood to our feet, then maybe we would put feet to what we've been thinking. Why don't we stand together? Today, again, we have celebrated the radical nature of the Christian life. We have sung songs that don't talk about me or exalting me or you. We have sung songs that exalted him, all glory and honor and power. We have witnessed two young people who have said, I will remain in the vine. We have looked at the radical teaching of Jesus that is not corporate America. It is organically being connected to the vine. It's the radical nature of the Christian life. Next Sunday, we are going to deal with such a powerful thought, and a lot of Christians never talk about it because it's too weird. It's too odd. And so we avoid it. And entire denominations will only pay it lip service. And so I thought, why don't we just jump into it next week? Because as a result of never talking about this subject, we often live a life of defeat, and we come to think that this is the normal Christian life, is kind of crawling on our knees to glory, and it is not. So next Sunday, we're going to talk about that. If you would like to pray with somebody today, this has been a meaningful time for you and a convicting time for you. We will have friends who will be at the front of the video cafe and the front of the main house, and they would love to pray with you. But before that, I'd like to commit you to the Lord. What a wonderful congregation you are, earnest and eager to remain in the vine. It's great. It's great. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, you, the vineyard owner, that you would have us as a branch on the vine, your son, is a marvelous miracle that we can't even take too much time to ponder. It's an amazing thing that you would reach out to us, like you would, that you would care about Riley when he's just a little child, that you would call him, that you would be gracious to Stephen, and that you would extend his life. We're just amazed at your goodness to us. And we want, oh God, to be fruitful. As individual Christians and as a church family, we want fruit that lasts, not just leaves, but fruit, and that comes solely from you, Lord Jesus. So I pray for my friends here as they seek to abide in you, to remain in you, and let you produce in them what you want. Oh, Lord, would you help us to look increasingly, individually and corporately like you, the Master. So bless your people today. Some of them are in the midst of pruning. And give them a desire to be fruitful and for you to do all that you want in their life. And for others who are in a time of fruitfulness, increase our fruit. Increase it. To your glory, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, everybody. It's great to have you here. Maybe more baptisms next week, maybe.
Are you hurting, broken, thin, overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling.